went downtown, got this guy, the OLPC. Do you know what the OLPC is? I've always wanted one of these. This is probably a, it came out in 2008 maybe? Yeah, around 2008, maybe 2007. OLPC stood for one laptop per child. And basically this company was taking bids on these machines to send to Africa. And the thing is, they had to be self-sufficient. They had to run Linux. They had to have like an all-day battery life. And there was something else, I forget what it was, something about the internet. I think they had to do like a mesh network or something. So let's go open this guy up, take a look at, well, not open it up, but let's take a look at it first. Yeah, paid $40. It was on sale, well, it's regularly $59, and I paid $39. Still, it's worth the drive to Toronto. All right, so what we have here is a very rugged laptop that looks like a toy. And as you can see, I'm spinning it all around here. It's like a 360 laptop. It does have a proprietary charger. The screen swivels, as you can see, not 360, but it does swivel around. And then when it goes into this mode, it can become a reader. Now the thing with these are the antennae, whatever you might want to call them. And not only are they antenna, but when you close it and you lock them, they lock it so the lid can't open. And the way that it works is there is a little groove right here that you can see that this then locks into. It's really cool engineering. So let's do a quick walk around on it while we're here. So obviously it closes. You got the single hinge. Over here we have the power. That is probably a USB 1. Headphone, microphone, antenna, USB, micro HDMI, which was pretty much unheard of in 2007, 2008. You open it up, like I said, it does swivel. We have a speaker, very tinny speakers. We have what looks like a bit like a D-pad over here. On this side, we have a bit what looks like a PlayStation controller with a square, circle, check mark, and X. That's your power button. Your notification lights down here. This little button down here is for rotating the screen so that you can go into reading mode, for example, or you can use it upside down or whatever way you want. This is the camera. These two, I believe, are the stereo speakers. And I believe this is a light sensor, if I had to guess. Now, underneath here, I don't know if you can really see it, but there's an SD card reader right under there. It's just awkward enough that I don't know if you'd actually be able to put an SD card in there. See it? I guess you could put it in there. And underneath here, we have the battery, which I have no idea how many milliamp it is. I'm not gonna pop, well, I guess, well, I'm already here. Let's pop it open. OLPC CL1 rechargeable battery. Unlimited charge voltage, 7.5 volt. 3.1, I guess that's milliamp, 20.15 watt hours, OLPC XO-4 touch. Yes, it's a touch screen, which you gotta say is pretty damn cool too. Man, and this thing is a right royal pain in the ass if you don't get it right the first time. So it goes in there, is it going this way? Yeah, it goes in like that. Okay. So we know that it's off. We've taken out the battery. This is operating a version of Linux Fedora. It's running Fedora. I don't know which version, but it's a GNOME-based, and it also has another overlay on it called Sugar. So let's turn this on and see how long it takes. 3, 2, 1, press. I wish I could capture that sound. It's a really tinny Windows startup sound, or a really tinny startup sound. Now the thing is, this also came with a hand crank. You could buy these little hand crank chargers for them, or maybe that was an option, I don't recall. But, well, you could charge it up that way, which it was just basically a charger that charge the battery using a little hand crank, and it actually attached to the desk. It was really quite cool to see. All right, we are in and running. So this is sugar. This is the, well, this is the overlay. This is the main thing that the kids would deal with at this point. And all these apps inside this little circle here are the favorites. So when you click on them and you play with them, you can see that they turn green and that becomes the favorite app of the kid. And most of these really are just apps. And they're fun things to play with. Like there's a sound machine and there's talking and then there's the web browser. This here plays pianos. That's like an art program. So they're quite cool little programs. Nothing special, but they do get the child to use the mouse, learn how it works, and just interact with it more. Now, if you do want to get out of there, and let's say we want to go into the GNOME version of Linux, and we'll leave it unknown, I guess. Date, time, modem configuration, language, frame, network, power, switch desktop, software update. So we're going to go into switch desktop. And it's like, do you want to switch from the active desktop environment of Sugar, which is the graphical interface that you're looking at for a learning environment designed for children, or do you want to switch to GNOME? And the thing with GNOME, we'll restart it now, is that I actually had to go into GNOME so that I could set up the Wi-Fi. Because the thing with the Wi-Fi is I could not get into it in the settings when I was trying to set up the wireless. Okay, and there you are. That is a desktop that most of us are familiar with. Just a standard, you know, accessories, graphics, internet, office, programming, sound, video, system tools, other places, for example, network. It does have a terminal as well, too. I'm not overly familiar with Fedora commands, so I'm not going to run anything through there. But other than that, it looks like a pretty common desktop. I mean, you have your battery up here, you have your Wi-Fi over there. Oh, and did I mention that it's a touchscreen? It is ahead of its time. At least I thought it was ahead of its time. And now let's talk about the screen for a second. This, as you can tell, is a color screen. Like you can see there's different shades of blue and green and red and everything on there. But watch what happens. Let's see if I can open up a kind of a pretty page. So I'm going to open up the web browser, Control A, C, actually let's go to CBC because we're in Canada, CBC.ca. The keyboard is horrible, but it's waterproof. Now it doesn't have a lot of travel, and that's probably my biggest issue with the keyboard. It does have a variety of keys on there I'm not familiar with, but the fact is, you know, it does the trick. All right, so here's a screen. It's obviously not perfect. All right, now, all right, there's a very colorful screen. This is probably an ad or something. All right, so check out all those colors. Now, this is where things get a little crazy. I'm going to take an artificial sunlight, which is my lamp, and I'm going to apply it to that screen and watch what happens. See that? It switches with light on it. It switches to a, it goes from basically being a color screen to just a generic LCD screen like you'd find on a calculator or like a Kindle, like an older ebook or something. So then this becomes, instead of being color, it just goes to like monochrome. And that way kids can then read that in extreme daylight. How cool is that? That is definitely way ahead of its time. And there we are, back to color. And I don't think it's anything magical. I don't think any kind of Harry Potter thing is being done here. It's really just when the direct light is on there, it is taking away all the color pixels. I think that's what the light sensor is doing. And it's converting it to, well, just generic black and white, I guess. It's still, it's so slick. And one thing I do like about this too is that when you go into this mode, and let's just switch it around here. So say I want to read it as a tablet, I just got to press this button here several times. And there we are. Now it's a tablet. doesn't work with this D-pad. And there's a keyboard. That came out of nowhere. You have to admit, that is pretty damn cool. And I can just sit it there, and I can, it has a video viewer, for example. I wish my fingers are smaller.
Like I said, let's take a quick look at the keyboard. This is probably my biggest complaint about this whole machine. And the fact that these keys have no travel in them. So when you start pressing them, like, you can feel them, they're covered in like this rubber membrane because it is supposed to be waterproof. But there's just no travel on the keys. So it feels like there isn't much response. So what I can tell here is that this is your brightness, this is your volume. I have no idea what these do or what these do. I guess that's your search button. This is probably your escape. This is the Windows. What is this little hand down here? I have no idea. Arrow buttons over here, math buttons. You know, for what it is, it does the trick pretty well. All right, let's dive a bit into the operating system. So we have a list view of all the apps. We have the favorites view. Oh, look at that, they got an abacus, browse, calculate. Books. Get books. What is that? If you can't tell, it says last updated 13 years ago. I guess you actually have to click on the icon before it does anything. Action and adventure, fairy tales, performing lookup. Oh, look at this. So does this mean, I guess these are all open source books that we can download. So if I want to download Journey to the Center of the Earth by Jules Verne, I can just say get book. And it looks like it downloads it. Now, the question is, can I read it? Show in journal? No preview. I have no idea how you'd read it. Play? Is that how you read it? Now that's rather cool. Now, can I just change pages? Anyway, for some reason, I can't seem to get out of this. Oh, this I do like though. This is the speaking utility.
Hello, Exo Mike. Please type something. So hard to type.
Alright. Maybe you may want to change the pitch.
Rate adjusted. Pitch adjusted. Eyes changed.
Okay, still, how do I get out of this? The software is confusing. That's all I have to say about it. It might take a bit of work to get to know, but I'm not going to invest a lot of time into it right now. Okay, so I think that we have pretty much covered this OLPC and everything that it can and cannot do. So I'd like to thank you for watching this. If you have any questions about it, leave them in the comments below. If you like this kind of video, hit that thumbs up. If not, hit a thumbs down. I am easy either way. I'm looking forward to seeing you next time we cover a machine. And I do appreciate you coming by here. So, until then, be sure to...
please subscribe. Thanks for watching. See you next week. And fade to black.